The term caput medusae is used to describe the distended and engorged umbilical veins that are radiating across the umbilicus. So here we can see a famous Caravaggio picture of Medusa, and on the second image we can see multiple distended veins radiating from the umbilicus. And there is definitely some resemblance with Medusa picture. Caput medusae develops due to the portal hypertension. And usually in patients with caput medusae we can also see esophageal varices and hemorrhoids, simply because they all portosystemic shunts and thereby they have the same pathogenic mechanism. And also in patients with caput medusae most likely we can determine splenomegaly. All conditions that cause portal hypertension can cause caput medusae. And we have three most common conditions. It's veno-occlusive disease, portal vein thrombosis, and Bud Chiari syndrome. To explain why caput medusae develops, we have to recall splanchnic circulation. Initially, left ventricle pushes blood into the aorta. And from aorta, blood is going into the splenic artery that supplies blood to the spleen, and mesenteric arteries that supply blood to the intestine, where in mesenteric capillaries fluid exchange occurs. Then blood from the spleen by splenic vein and from the intestine by mesenteric veins is delivered to the portal vein. Portal vein drains blood into the liver, where in liver capillaries that we call sinusoids, fluid exchange occurs. After fluid exchange in liver capillaries, blood is going to the hepatic vein, and from hepatic vein, blood is drained to the inferior vena cava. But also we have to know that in this system we have additional vessels that remain from embryogenesis. Such vessels we call portosystemic collateral blood vessels. Back in times of embryogenesis, these vessels were crucial. They provided flow to esophageal and gastric veins. Also, they provided flow to paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins that are located on anterior abdominal wall. And also, they provided flow to upper anal canal veins. And from these veins, blood is drained into the inferior vena cava. Adult person in normal condition practically do not use portosystemic collateral vessels, because adult person has portal vein pump line that provides massive blood flow. From inferior vena cava, blood goes into the right atrium and right ventricle of the heart, then blood crosses pulmonary circulation and goes into the left atrium and left ventricle, and from left ventricle, heart again pushes blood into the aorta. So the cycle can be repeated over and over again. We also have to know that flow from the portal vein through the liver into the inferior vena cava is equal to pressure inside the portal vein minus pressure inside the inferior vena cava divided on resistance between them, which is actually resistance in the liver blood vessels. And the resistance is inversely proportional to the force power of radius. Let's take cirrhosis. In cirrhosis, chronic liver damage causes progressive deposition of fibrous tissue in the liver parenchyma. And at some point, fibrosis becomes so massive that fibrous tissue begins to compress liver sinusoids. As a result, cirrhosis causes decreasing radius of the sinusoids. With decreasing radius, resistance increases and thereby blood flow decreases. So now fluid cannot pass into the hepatic vein, and fluid begins to accumulate in the liver sinusoids. Then the backflow of fluid causes accumulation of fluid in the portal vein, and with increasing amount of fluid in the portal vein, the hydrostatic pressure in the portal vein increases. To explain this, we have to recall physics. We know that hydrostatic pressure is directly proportional to the fluid volume. So with increasing volume of fluid, hydrostatic pressure increases. And increase in hydrostatic pressure inside the portal vein we call portal hypertension. The problem is that progressive increase in hydrostatic pressure causes progressive increase in wall tension, and at some point it will cause rupture of the portal vein. So organism has to decompress portal vein, and it's the moment when portosystemic collateral vessels come into play. So now a large portion of excess fluid goes into the only vessels available, which are portosystemic collateral vessels. Income of excess fluid into the esophageal and gastric veins causes their dilation with formation of esophageal varices. Income of excess fluid into the paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins causes their dilation with formation of caput medusae. And income of excess fluid into the upper anal canal veins causes their dilation with formation of hemorrhoids. And then excess blood goes into the inferior vena cava, so by collateral vessels we can drain some excess fluid from the portal vein into the inferior vena cava. But how to explain how excess blood causes dilation of paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins? To explain this, there is a vessel with fluid inside it. Fluid flow occurs from left to right, and fluid has some hydrostatic pressure. And as we know, hydrostatic pressure acts in all directions. Recall that hydrostatic pressure is basically a weight of fluid that acts on a particular area. And weight of fluid equals to mass of fluid times gravity constant. In turn, mass of fluid equals to fluid density times fluid volume. So basically, volume and hydrostatic pressure are directly related. Also, we have to know that because hydrostatic pressure acts in all directions, it determines the wall tension. Recall that wall tension is determined by the Laplace law. Laplace law states that the wall tension is equal to pressure difference between the pressure that acts from the inside of the blood vessel minus pressure that acts from the outside of the blood vessel. Also, wall tension is directly proportional to the radius of the vessel and inversely proportional to the thickness of the vessel. So the higher the volume of fluid inside the vessel, the higher becomes hydrostatic pressure. And with increase in hydrostatic pressure, wall tension increase. So in this case, because of fibrosis, the inflow of blood to portosystemic collateral vessels increase. With increase in fluid inflow, more volume of fluid will be located inside the vessel. With increase in volume, hydrostatic pressure increase. With increase in hydrostatic pressure, wall tension increase. Increase in wall tension causes vessel wall distension. Because collateral vessels are veins and veins have very high compliance, they can be very easily distended. Basically, they are like balloons. And such over-distended paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins create this medusa-like image on anterior abdominal wall. The more severe becomes portal hypertension, the more fluid goes into the portosystemic shunts. The higher the volume of fluid, the higher becomes hydrostatic pressure. The higher the hydrostatic pressure, the higher will be vessel wall tension. And thereby, the more distended will be the paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins. So basically, the more severe becomes portal hypertension, the more prominent becomes caput medusae on anterior abdominal wall. On this image, we can see a large caput medusae, and we can visualize these huge veins on CT. As we see, it's huge distension of the portal vein that creates distension of the paraumbilical and superficial epigastric veins. Also, there is a huge spleen, because splenomegaly is also one of the manifestations of the portal hypertension. On this image, there is also large caput medusae on anterior abdominal wall. On next image, we can see that caput medusae caused by dilation of paraumbilical and periumbilical veins. And here we also see how distension of the portal vein creates caput medusae.